This is my Father's world, your Father's world. Let's realize that, and if we do, we'll treat it in a totally different way. I'm Larry Rice, and we're moving into the world of creation. This is my Father's world and your Father's world. Let all that hath breath and life praise the Lord. Listen to what it says to us in Psalm 24, 1 and 2. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. God was quite emphatic over the fact that it was his earth. In fact, he didn't want his people to say, this is mine, this is yours. In Leviticus chapter 25, verse 23, it says, the land must not be sold permanently because the land is mine, and you are but aliens and my tenants. Aliens and tenants, people who are here temporarily, people who are given the job of being custodians, earth keepers and not earth breakers. Yes, the realization that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof causes us to treat creation different. But hasn't the time come that we also need to take a serious 2 Chronicles 7:14, where it says, my people who are called by my name will turn from their wicked ways and call upon me. I will hear from heaven and heal their land, the wicked ways. We see the polluted streams. We see the global warming becoming more and more of a reality every day. The ozone layer being destroyed. The destruction all around us. And do we care? Do we care what future generations will be left with as we try to possess the earth as our own, rather than the realization that it is our Father's house, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof? He's calling us as his people to repentance at this hour. He's calling us into a deeper relationship with him. He told Adam and Eve that they were to be earth keepers. And in fact, they became very much aligned with the world, particularly when Adam gave a name to everything. When you name something, it builds a relationship. And from that relationship comes forth love, love for God's creation. And that's what he's calling us to have at this time, to realize that we're on his boat. We're on his ark in this vast universe. And to stop seeing all the holes plugged into it and all the destruction unfolding in it, realizing this is the only ark, the only earth that we are on. This planet is the only one that we have, this planet. And so we have the responsibility of caring for our Father's world. We have the reality upon us that this destruction is unfolding, and the time for each and every one of us to take serious the commandments, to be pro-life from the womb to the tomb. And be pro-life means to be an environmentalist, means to take care of God's environment, to let his light and his love flow in us and through us at such an hour like this.
Destroying the environment is sin, as Romans 6:23 says. The wages of sin is death. Death to vegetation, fish, birds, animals, and even humans. Death to clean air, fresh water, and life as we know it is a sin. As Numbers 32:23 says, and you may be sure that your sin will find you out. Yet all is not hopeless. God is a God of mercy, forgiveness, and restoration. In the scriptures, he promises, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14. In order to see our land healed spiritually, socially, and environmentally, we must agree, number one, that we have sinned against God, both through our silence and in environmental issues, and through our direct sins against the environment as a result of our gluttonous lifestyles. As a result, we have neglected our responsibilities to preserve and protect our environment and its resources, as well as be accountable stewards of it. Number two, the healing of the land involves repentance, resulting in a change of direction concerning the way that we do things. It involves the realization that Scripture speaks of both creation and redemption, knowing that God has called us to care for his earth as we await the restoration of it through the return of Lord Jesus Christ. And as Paul proclaims in Romans 8:19-24, the creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed.
The community of faith can no longer remain silent. We can no longer stand back and watch the ongoing destruction of the world as we know it. Jesus said that salt that's lost its savor, its penetrating power, its ability to make a difference in the world is not even fit for the dunghill. We are a people that God is calling forth at this particular hour. He's fully equipped us with His Word, the wonders of His creation, and He's fully equipped us with the power of the Holy Spirit. And now He's desiring to send us forth. Send us forth into a world that's being raped, robbed, and destroyed all around us. Send us forth to declare to those who are utility slaves that Jesus has come to set the captives free. Those slaves to the big oil companies, that there are alternatives, clean alternatives. An opportunity has come upon us at this particular time to do it different. But to declare that things need to be done different is difficult for those who are married to the status quo. They will do everything they can to support such a status quo. It takes faith, it takes courage to stand up at this particular time and let our voice be heard. The scriptures demand that we can do no other. We hear and clearly in the Word, for example, Psalm 111, verse 2, where it declares, "Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who have pleasure in them." Now, if we realize that these are God's works, we aren't going to be able to just continue to be indifferent. We're going to do everything we can to protect the works of God as we're mandated to do such in the Scriptures. And again, throughout the Scriptures, we see there the works of God. Psalm 77:12, "I will meditate on all your works, consider all your mighty ways." When we look at creation and all the manifestations of God's goodness and glory and power and presence, we can't help but break into praise like Psalm 150 does, where it says, "All that hath breath and life, praise the Lord." We know that the time has come at this moment for us to no longer just sit back in silence, but instead be that penetrating salt that He's calling forth to preserve His creation, to preserve His wonders and works. Revelations 4 says, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. He created all things, and by his will they have their being. And so you and I work for the preservation of creation. We seek God, and perhaps we start out in small ways. It may just be simple recycling, as simple as that may seem, yet very important. Trading out our incandescent light bulbs for compact fluorescent light bulbs. Looking and seeing how we can save energy in every way. Not only does it put money back in our pockets so we can help those who are in need, but it also helps us to save when it comes to burning the fossil fuels. And then looking to see how we can be set free from those fossil fuels by using solar power, wind power, and much more. Yes, this is our Father's world. We want to do everything we can to protect this world. We want to be earth keepers, not earth breakers. And we want to continue to seek him as to ways that we can be truly creative and productive in the saving us as his creation. For not only are we pro-life in word, but definitely in deed when it comes to saving all of life. For we see that this life is truly the works and wonders of the living God.
For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who are the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in the hope we were saved. God's word has compelled us to become more concerned about our environment. This means we need to repent of unspoken belief that more is better and that more and more materialistic things bring fulfillment. The time has come for us to consume less and switch to renewable resources. This means breaking free from a prosperity theology whose people are trapped in materialism, which treasures things more than Jesus. Jesus is Lord, and he has called us to save his creation and to work for a justice that involves the empowerment of the poor. Remember, the earth is good. As Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Over and over in Genesis 1, we see God declaring that what was created is good. It is human sin which spoils the earth.
on this journey of life, it's impossible to say to separate Christ's redemptive role from his role of creation. They're one and the same. Yes, Christ was present at creation. We see that clearly in the scriptures. Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He's the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all of creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. Jesus is both our redeemer and he is our creator. And through his love, his divine epoxy, all things are held together. Now, realizing that that is the role that Christ performs and that we are ambassadors for Christ, we are the followers of Jesus Christ, we're going to be acting different, looking different, and being different. The trouble is that many who say that they're followers of Christ engage in the ongoing destruction of his creation because of their obsessiveness with all the materialism. They will destroy, rob, and rape this world, even though the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So those who are truly alive in the Lord will repent of such a sin. They will truly take serious when Jesus says that we are the salt of the earth. Salt penetrates, salt preserves, and salt that's lost its savor, salt that's lost its penetration power, its preserving power, is worthless, he said. So may we indeed seek God that we can be truly productive and effective at such a time like this, that his Son, his light, his life may flow in us and through us. Yes, Christ is our Redeemer. To stress only his redemptive qualities without recognizing the fact that he is also our Creator is for us to often remove ourselves from this very real world of creation that we live in. To recognize that God is Creator and yet not Redeemer causes us to be in a world constantly questioning, why is there so much pain? Why is there so much suffering? What's wrong with this creation if God has made it? And to ultimately perhaps get angry at God. But there's a better route. And it is to realize that yes, Christ is fully God, he's fully man, that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son to redeem this sin-stricken world filled with its sin, its hurt, its pain, and offers us hope. Yes, in him we find that warehouse of hope. We find the hope to be more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. We find the hope to be victorious at such a time like this. We find the hope to be earth keepers rather than earth breakers. We find the hope to continue to remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work and the will of God, in spite of the fact that this world as we know it may be becoming increasingly hostile toward those who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ, as well as to God's environment. They may say in name only that they're environmentalists, but yet turn from the greatest environmentalist of all, the Almighty God who created heaven and earth, and not only created it, fully creator, but also when sin came and began to destroy such, he sent his only begotten Son to redeem all of creation. For God so loved the world, the cosmos, all of creation. Let all that hath breath and life praise the Lord. By making the redemptive message one exclusively relating just to human beings causes us to somehow come on a spiritual lofty perch where we look down on the rest of creation and do not see Christ's redemptive power at work in the rest of creation. And that's why in Romans chapter 8, it says that all of creation is groaning for the redemption of mankind. Because when people are fully redeemed and fully made alive, then such a people are earth keepers, not earth breakers. There are people who are deeply engaged in preserving creation, for they see that all of creation is praising God, even the smallest of species, way back in the woods somewhere. Yes, the birds from the time before the sun comes up in the morning, then the crickets and the squirrels and all of creation all day praises God, and then throughout the night we can hear the sounds of praise. For truly all that hath breath and life, let it praise the Lord. Fully redeemer, fully creator, and fully one who wants us to recognize that this is our Father's world. And to begin to move in the midst of that world, proclaiming hope and help in word and deed, reaching out, letting the love of Jesus Christ flow through us, even into the lives of the least of these.
Repeatedly throughout Scripture, we see God warning that if his people are unfaithful to his covenant, the land will suffer, Hosea 4:1-3. We need people who are pro-life to the extent they support policies that are pro-earth. A true pro-life ethic respects the life of the earth and realizes that such a respect carries over to human life. Rachel Carson, in her timeless classic, Silent Spring, points this out when she said, "Water, soil, and the earth's green mantle of plants make up the world that supports the animal life of the earth." Although modern man seldom remembers the fact, he cannot exist without the plants that harness the sun's energy and manufacture the basic foodstuffs he depends on for life. A pro-life ethic that respects the life of the earth realizes that God made and loved the earth, and that all of our life and health depends on the health of the earth. Now is the time for us to walk up and realize that the presentation of the earth is not just God's responsibility, it is ours also. It's clear from Genesis 1 and 2 that man and woman are to care for the earth. Sin did not cancel this responsibility. It just made the issue of stewardship all the more critical. Humankind has miserably failed to fulfill its stewardship of the earth. Mankind has done to the earth what it has done to each other: exploited, ruined, oppressed, raped, and ravaged. This is a direct disobedience to the Almighty God. The time for repentance is now. We have failed in fulfilling God's greatest mandates, which include being stewards of creation and participation with Him in His work of redemption.
Have been given a mission to be earth keepers and not earth breakers, to become a part of God's wonderful chorus of praise, for it is our Father's world. We have a mission. Nehemiah had a mission. Here's what he had to say about his mission, Nehemiah 2:17. You see the trouble we're in? Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild and we will no longer be a disgrace. We as Generation X have been called to see the ruin around us and to rebuild. Yes, our mandate is larger even than that of Nehemiah's. to rebuild. For truly, this is our Father's world, and He has called us into it, and He's called us to be a part of it at this time, and in this place. So the challenge that exists to each one of us is to recognize that this is our Father's world, and we see the mess that we're in, and we're going to seek Him as to how we can recreate it, how we can be earth keepers, how we can, move in the creation that He has thrust before us to care for it and take care of it. The people replied, Nehemiah 2:18, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. Are you going to reply? He says, choose this day either death or life. Also, as Elijah told the people, choose you this day the God you're going to serve, the God of materialism, the God of Baal, or the living God in our Father's world. And as a result, being earth keepers involves not only caring for the birds and the animals and the sea and the trees and the flowers and all of creation, but also those that Jesus referred to as the least of these. He said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, visit me? A stranger, did you welcome me? The same principle applies. Those that would rape and rob and destroy creation because they think that they can dominate it, and to them subduing it means to step on it and lord over it. Thank God God doesn't see His role that way. They are going to be totally out of tune with the fact that we're to love our neighbors, we love ourselves. Loving our neighbors, we love ourselves, recognizes the need to preserve creation for future generations, and not just take that which is expedient, not only take that which is convenient, not only take that which adds to our creature comforts, but instead we'll preserve this creation that God has given us for future generations. And we'll also work to preserve those that Jesus referred to as the least of these. The hour of opportunity is before us. The mission has been given to us. It's a noble mission to recognize this is our Father's world and to be earth keepers, not earth breakers. I want to refer you to a number of websites, www.moreenergy.org, all kinds of opportunities there to show you how to be an earth keeper and to move in the world of renewable energy, or www.AmericanRenewableEnergy.org. That's www.AmericanRenewableEnergy.org. Our many lessons that we've done utilizing the Word of God to help us to realize how to be earth keepers, not earth breakers, at www.LarryRiceMinistries.org. So there's a lot of free studies there, a lot of opportunities awaiting you, and then you can also learn more about helping those and that are a part of this creation and protecting those that perhaps are the most vulnerable, the homeless, the hurting, the hungry, by going to www.NewLifeEvangelisticCenter.org. God has given us so many different opportunities at this particular hour to protect our Father's world. Let's do it. Let's go forth in the name of our resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who's fully Redeemer, as Colossians chapter 1 said, also Creator.